Good morning. I know I'm not a mom, but good morning. That's a little better. It's great to be back. Happy Mother's Day, you moms. Just raise your hand if you're a mom. Just do this. About 50% or better. I know you just got comfortable. We're going to teach a couple new choruses. Can you stand with us? Let's worship the Lord together. Love. Amen. This is an easy one to learn as well.
The truth and the life. the truth and the life you are, the way, the truth and the life. You're the reason for my happiness, you're the one that filled my emptiness. Oh yes, you're the way, you're the way for me, you're the truth and your truth to set me free. Truth and alive, you are the way, the truth and alive, you are the way, the truth and alive, you are the way, the truth and
try it again.
You are the way, the truth, and the life. You are the way, the truth, and the life. You are the way, the truth.
Thank you.
Amen. Again, it's great to be here in Ithaca. Please, please don't get sick of us because we enjoy being here. And how about if you get sick of us, we'll still come. Just to help with your patience and endurance. But it's great to be back. We live in Grand Rapids, so not too far. And this whole next week, we have a conference in Toronto. So we don't have our kids with us. We call them kids because they're our offspring. But they're 20 and 17 years old. Our son is a junior in high school. And his last day of school, we homeschool, but he's a part of a PTC. That's this coming Thursday. So we didn't want him to miss that. And I really missed him when we brought in all the heavy equipment. But Guy was a blessing. Yeah, thank you, buddy. And then our daughter's 20, and she just got home. I just picked her up from Moody Bible Institute in Chicago on Thursday. So with finals and everything, she's just kind of staring off into space, not knowing where she's at. So we're letting her rest. And exams did that for me, too, when I was her age. And but we are honored to be here and to celebrate Mother's Day with you. It is our honor. I've got a pretty great mom for my kids. And you did an awesome job on the road, honey, raising those kids. And we only, forgot them, left them behind in a couple places. And the therapy worked, and it was all a good.
We actually did do that one time. The kids were young. They were like 8 and 10. And we had three concerts in one day. And so the morning concert, we got this equipment down so quickly, and we had so much help. And we were just rushing. And we get everything in the car, and we grab in our clothes, and we throw everything in the car, and we jump in the front seat, and Randy takes off, and we pull out of the church parking lot. We get on about a quarter of a mile. And I turn around and went, kids, we turn back around and we pull into the church parking lot, and they're standing out there with the pastor, and the pastor said, we're just standing here making a bet on how far you'd get. If the kids tell the story, we left in there like 2 weeks.
Yeah, it was about 2 weeks. Yeah, it was about 2 weeks. But we got a lot better. Not forgetting once they memorize Child Protective Services telephone number. Then I sharpened up. Yeah. So they love this place. They remember you guys, and they'll look forward to the next time, and we'll look forward to having them with us. We're blessed to just fill a practical purpose of giving Pastor a well-deserved break. We know he wears lots of hats, and he does it very well. And he, again, apologized. I'm sorry, I won't be there. And I said, it's okay. We just eat cake and sit and talk. No, I didn't tell him that. But he's now that we're on YouTube, I guess he might click in. So he asked for this song. And I'm like, why would you ask for a song? You're not going to be there. But I'm going to honor that request because he might watch or listen later. So this is for him. Here we go.
Thank you.
the ringing in my ears. Can I really know the honest truth? Life is full of choices. There's laughter with the tears. You know my eyes are fixed. Your word you've shown me, and it's really overdue. I want you to show me the way
every day.
I want you to show me the way. I want you day after day.
I'm alone.
I can't see the forest for the trees. This road is leading nowhere, so I'm falling on my knees.
Go back a little bit to an album we did quite a few years ago, a live album, and a song, a chorus that I wrote that means a lot to me and helped me through some difficult times in my ministry and the loss of some loved ones and specifically our senior pastor, and where we had to continue to go on without his leadership. And I was reminded of Job and how when things rained down on him, what he did, look it up, is he worshiped. It's a great response to say, God, you are God, and I am not, and I trust you in this time of valley. I want to teach it to you. It's called I Want to Worship.
I want to grow beyond my years, want to conquer all my fears. Want my love to be unbridled to your throne. For if all that I can do is to raise my voice to you, I want to worship. 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 Worship you. I want to worship. I want to worship.
is the proof, my living testimony of how God grants grace beyond my need. And I know I was made to give God all my praise, for He is worthy to be seen in me. Want to grow beyond my years, want to conquer all my fears. I want my love to be unbridled to your throne. For if all that I can do is to raise my voice to you, I want to worship. I want to worship. Want to worship.
Sing with us.
I want to worship. I want to worship. I want to worship.
Worship you.
I want to worship. I want to worship. Want to
just as the trees and the birds do what their creator has asked them to do. You think about it. I was praising the Lord on the way here this morning, early this morning, to see a couple crows eating some roadkill. And you think, wow, Randy, you're pretty weird for giving thanks for that, you know? Even God said, take care of that. That's your food. So that things are in proper order. We'd have some problems if roadkill just stayed there, right? What'd you learn in church today? That roadkill is a blessing. I'm glad I hit that deer. No. But the crows, when they eat the way they're supposed to eat, get it? It's worship to them, because they're doing exactly what God's asked them to do. And so that's really a great, simple definition, isn't it? When you do exactly what God wants you to do, what He's exactly called you and created you to do, that's worship. And so can you worship by baking a pie and taking it to your neighbor and being a blessing? That's worship. And when we come together corporately and we just bring all of our blessings together and offer it up to Him and say, God, You are so good. You are so good to us. We just want to take this hour, it's just an hour out of our week, and come together with our brothers and sisters and thank You. So let's do that. this morning.
Can you hear the sound of heaven like the sound of many waters? It's the sound of worship coming from the throne. There are cries of adoration as men from every nation lift their voice to make his glory known, singing, holy, holy, holy are you, Lord. Holy, holy, holy are you, Lord. The elders and angels bow, the redeemed worship you now. Holy, holy, holy are you, Lord. Can you hear the sound of heaven like the sound of many waters? It's the sound of worship coming from the throne. Cries of adoration as men from every nation lift their voice to make his glory known, singing, holy, holy, holy are you, Lord. Holy, holy, holy are you, Lord. The elders and angels bow, the redeemed worship you now. Holy, holy, holy are you, Lord.
Sing it to him.
Holy, holy, holy are you, Lord.
It's good to tell the Lord that he's holy, because he is. Amen. Let's sing it together.
Holy, holy. Thank you.
Father, you are holy, and we praise your name. We lift you up. This time belongs to you, Lord. We give you our attention because you are worthy, and you are the eternal, only living God. And we put our faith and our trust in you. And God, we have this expectation that you change our lives. So, Father, we come expecting that. And, Lord, I know it's going to cost us something. So I pray, Father, that you would soften our hearts and make us willing to sacrifice in order to receive your blessing. We're not earning it, Lord. We're just honoring you with our lives. So, God, will you soften the soil of our hearts? Lord, will you set people free this morning? Will you deliver? Will you give hope? Give strength to the weary? Rest, comfort to the downhearted? I have great expectations for today, Lord. I praise your name, and I give you my time and my attention, Lord. In your name we pray, amen. Well, it is an honor to be with you. And what beautiful families I see sitting together. That's just so lovely. That's so lovely. I miss my kids. We're leaving, obviously, right from here. We drive to Toronto, so we'll be gone for a week. So there's part of me that goes, hey, it's Mother's Day. I'm not with my kids. And then I go, hey, I got my whole life to be with my kids. Freedom. 7 days. Kind of excited. Can you not put that on YouTube, please? Before I share with you what's on my heart, and I'm so excited to share this, I just want to tell you really quickly about our table. A lot of people miss it. So I just want to tell you, we have CDs on our table. The Road Less Traveled is our newest CD. Some of the songs we've done today are on there. Randy has a piano CD. It's called 88. It's all that light, fun, jazz style of piano. There's no singing on that. It's just music. I have a speaking CD. It's just speaking. There's no music on this at all, no singing or piano. It's just speaking. People asked me to do that first in the year, so I didn't. It's just about being grounded in the love of God. So that's just all speaking. Who's a mom? Who's a mom? Here, I'll give you a CD. Happy Mother's Day. Who's a mom? Who's a mom? There you go. One more. I need one more. Another mom. Oh, look at nobody's raising their hand. Nobody wants it, huh? All right, I get it, all right. Okay, so the other cool thing that we have is, this is called a Read and Grow Picture Bible, and I want to show you this because so many people, I can't keep these on the table, so I have what I have, and then they're gone. It's the whole Bible. It's in comic strip form, so grandmas are grabbing these things to read with their grandkids when they come over. It's really cool. So you can look at that. It's on our table, and then I wrote a book about a year ago. It's called Riding Shotgun. If you know anything about our ministry, you know that for 8 years we lived in a motorhome with no other house. We just lived in a camper. Oh, thank you. And you already own it, so I'm not giving it to you. Any brown nosing? No, I'm kidding.
Thanks, Uncle Joe. Appreciate it. No.
Yeah. we're a year in, and my kids still have yet to read it. So maybe for Mother's Day, they'll read my book. Doubt it. My son's waiting for the movie. That's what he told me. Anyway, I get to talk about a lot of miracles and adventures and wonderful things that God taught me. Most of all, he taught me to ride in the passenger seat and to let him drive. And he is a phenomenal driver, but he is not and will nor he ever be a chauffeur. Yes, we cut a hole in her bunk bed so her feet could stretch out. She had grown too tall. So
labor of love.
You know, you do what you gotta do. You do what you have to do. So, you know, I've really been praying about today, and I've been praying for you, and God really has put some things on my heart. So really quickly, I want to share this passage of scripture with you. This is This is 1 Samuel, and I want to give you a brief overview really quick of the part of scripture that I'm going to share with you. This is going to be really short. 1 Samuel, there's a man named Elkanah, and he had two wives, Peninnah and Hannah. God had given instruction in Genesis that marriage is between one man and one woman, and but the Israelites soon adopted polygamy. God didn't overlook it, but he was patient with it, which is really wild. He set this straight later on. But at this point, polygamy was part of their culture, and they adopted that. Didn't make it right, but they did. So Elkanah has two wives, Peninnah and Hannah. Peninnah has children, Hannah does not. And in that culture, your children for a woman established your value. So no children in that culture really meant no value. It also meant no future, because your children were the ones that were going to take care of you in your old age. So Hannah was literally taunted and tormented by Peninnah. And three times a year, the whole family would travel from Ramah to Shiloh, where the tabernacle was, for three different festivals. And they would offer the appropriate sacrifices for their family, and they would worship there at the tabernacle. So that's where we're going to pick it up. And this is 1 Samuel chapter 1, verse 8. And again, Peninnah is just taunting Hannah to the point to where Hannah is reduced to tears. She's making fun of her because she has no children. Hannah only gets one portion of choice meat, where Peninnah gets two portions because she has children. So Peninnah is just relentlessly, unkindly taunting her, and it makes Hannah sick. So sick that she can't eat. That's where we're going to pick it up. So Elkanah says to Hannah, "Why are you crying, Hannah? Why aren't you eating? Why be downhearted just because you have no children? You have me. Isn't that better than having 10 sons?" No. There is so much humor in the Bible. You just gotta pay attention. It's all right there. Once, after a sacrificial meal at Shiloh, Hannah got up and went to pray. Eli the priest, was sitting at his customary place inside the entrance of the tabernacle. Hannah was in deep anguish, crying bitterly as she prayed to the Lord. And she made this vow, "O Lord of heaven's armies, if you will look upon my sorrow and answer my prayer and give me a son, then I will give him back to you. He will be yours for his entire lifetime. As a sign that he has been dedicated to the Lord, his hair will never be cut." As she was praying to the Lord, Eli watched her, seeing her lips moving, but hearing no sound, he thought she had been drinking. "Must you come here drunk? Throw away your wine," he said to her. "Oh, no, sir," she replied. "I haven't been drinking wine or anything stronger. But I am very discouraged, and I was pouring my heart out to the Lord. Don't think that I am a wicked woman, for I've been praying out of great anguish and sorrow." "In that case," Eli said, "go in peace. May the God of Israel grant the request you have asked of him." Isn't it interesting that Hannah, when she is in such deep anguish and sorrow, knows exactly who to go to? She goes to God, and she pours her heart out. "Thank you, sir," she exclaimed. Then she went back and began to eat again, and she was no longer sad. The family goes home. Hannah gets pregnant. She thanks the Lord. She names him Samuel. The next year, Elkanah and his family went on their annual trip to offer a sacrifice for the Lord. But Hannah did not go. She told her husband, "Wait until the boy is weaned. Then I will take him to the tabernacle and leave him there with the Lord permanently." "Whatever you think is best," Elkanah agreed. "Stay here for now, and may the Lord help you keep your promise." So she stayed home and nursed the boy until he was weaned. In that culture, it was about 3 years old. which seems a really long time to breastfeed, but it seems really young to give your child away. When the child was weaned, Hannah took him to the tabernacle to Shiloh. They brought along a 3-year-old bull for the sacrifice and a basket of flour and some wine. After sacrificing the bull, they brought the boy to Eli the priest. "Sir, do you remember me?" Hannah asked. "I am the woman who stood here several years ago praying to the Lord. I asked the Lord to give me this boy, and he granted my request. Now I am giving him to the Lord, and he will belong to the Lord his whole life." And they worshiped the Lord there. So I want you to see a few things out of this. Number one, I want you to see when you're in deep anguish and in pain, and there's a hole in your heart for some reason, be really wise on who you go to. My suggestion is just be like Hannah and go to the Lord. Men and women, all of us, but ladies especially, because isn't it wild how we tend to wake up in the middle of the night worrying about our kids? Am I the only one? No, I'm not the only one. You wake up in the middle of the night. Who do you go to? You turn the TV on? You jump on Facebook? Go to the Lord. When your heart is full of anguish and there's pain and you're wondering what's going to happen next, go to the Lord. What about fasting and praying? Have you ever fasted and prayed for your kids? Have you ever picked a book of the Bible and read through it and studied it and then prayed through it for your children, inserting their name everywhere? Rewrite the book and literally write out your child's name in that place where there's a promise. And you watch what God does and how God sets your child free. I'll tell you what, I have a lot of moms come to me and say, "Will you pray for my children?" Yes, but not like you. It's not my kid. I'm not going to stay up all night worrying about your kid. I got two of my own. Nobody, girls, nobody is going to go to intercede and go to battle for your child like the Lord, and then you're second in line. Go to battle for your kid. You know there's an issue in your kid's life? Name it before the Lord every minute of every day. You grab a book of the Bible and you start praying that over your child, and you watch the chains fall off of your kid. Toss your husband in there too, by the way. That's a joke. So know who to go to. Look, I know. You know, Hannah was in deep, deep pain because she couldn't have children. I know that Mother's Day can be a really hard day for women. We celebrate Mother's Day and it's all fun and flowers, and but there are some women that are just in pain today. Maybe because they lost a child. Maybe because their children are in rebellion and there's no relationship there. Maybe because you lost your mom. Maybe you don't know where your mom is. There's a lot of pain that is associated with this day that we rarely talk about. And I don't want to be heavy today, and I want to be careful, and I want you to leave encouraged. So hang with me, okay? I promise to leave you here encouraged. But we got to talk about this. Maybe you made some decisions previously in your life, ladies, that you really regret today. You know, we've aborted over 60 million babies. And I've been in women's ministry a long time. And when women really, really, really have a lot of damage and destruction in their life, many times, not always, many times it comes back to two issues, sexual abuse and abortion. Many times. See, we talk about abortion in the church, but rarely do we connect abortion with women who've made that decision. We've got to be careful how we talk about abortion. Why? Because we've got moms and dads that are sitting that made that decision, and many of them regret wholeheartedly, and if they could go back in time to that moment, they would change their mind. And they're suffering in silence because they don't know where to go for freedom. Well, let me tell you today, the Lord forgives any confessed sin. In fact, let me say it better. The Lord forgives every confessed sin. even that. So if you are carrying this guilt and you're in this bondage, the Lord today wants you to be set free. He wants you to know that he loves you, and he doesn't want you to live the rest of your life in bondage. I came across a woman several years ago in chains. In chains. And we began to talk, and she told me her story. She, in fact, had made that decision to end the life of her child. And it had destroyed her life, as it does most. It destroyed her life. So I was praying for her and praying for her, asking God to set her free. And every time I would pray for her, I would pray and I would mention the baby. And it went on for weeks, and I prayed, and I would always mention the baby. And one day in my prayer time, the Holy Spirit said to me so clearly, "Marli, you know, that baby has a name." Never thought of that. That baby has a name. I said, "Well, of course, that baby is in your presence, Lord." And I was so bold to ask, "What is that baby's name?" And the Lord told me what I believed, the Lord said to me. So I took that challenge to this woman, and I emailed her, and I said, "You know, I was praying for you," and I explained to her what happened in my prayer time, but I did not tell her that the Lord had given me a name, and I did not tell her the name, of course. I said, "I just want to challenge you that this baby is real and living in the presence of God. She is not angry at you or he. She's not angry. And God wants you to be set free today. So pray about this. Pray about naming this child." A week later, I got an email from her with a simple statement. "I took you up on your challenge, and I prayed, and I asked God. And here is the name that God gave me." And you know the rest of the story. Exact same name. Is that incredible? Somebody go, "Wow. God, you're amazing." Why did God do that? Because he wanted a woman set free. It was an imperative that I knew the name of that child. It was imperative that one of God's children doesn't live in bondage the rest of her life because of a decision she made years ago when she wasn't walking with the Lord. God wants you free. And church family, we need to be careful how we speak of this issue. Oh, we need to speak of it because life is created in God's image. Oh, but we need to be so gentle and kind and considerate. So when you are in pain and anguish, who will you run to? Here's the next thing I want you to see about Hannah. She makes a promise to God, right? She says, "Lord, if you give me a son, I will in turn give him back to you. And his whole life, he'll serve you." I'm reading this and I'm going, but Hannah, it's not your life. It's your child's life. And you just dedicated this child for the Lord's service. Isn't it that child's right to choose what he's going to do with his life? Oh. As parents, as mothers, as fathers, we get to dedicate our children to something. It might be Nickelodeon. It might be video games. It might be soccer and outdoor sports. But why not? When our children are young, stop and think, what do I want my child to be dedicated to for the rest of his life? I better start now. And Hannah says, "Lord, I'm going to give you this son if you grant my request." Oh, be careful of the promises we make to God. Elkanah, her husband, says, "May the Lord help you keep your promise." That was his son too. So Hannah takes this child, goes back to Eli the priest and says, "Here is my 3-year-old. He will live with you here in the tabernacle so you can raise him up to be a priest. Not only did Samuel become a priest, he became a prophet of God and the greatest judge of Israel. In fact, the final judge of Israel, who anointed not only the first king of Israel, Saul, but David. What an honor. I mean, you are talking about Samuel, a powerful person of God. And I believe it was because a mom dedicated her kid to the Lord and was not a possessive mother. Do you know what I mean, possessive mother? I've believed some of these myself. We say this in our culture. We say, boys will be boys. We say, you will always be my baby. I started to say that to my son the other day because he's our youngest. You'll always be my baby. And I turned around and my baby was towering over me, holding his Bible, and all I could see was about the middle of his chest. And as I started to say that, instead I said, you will always be a man of God. You will always be a mighty warrior that is going to be effective in the kingdom, and you will always be near and dear to my heart. You will always be my favorite son. You will always be in my prayers. But you are not a baby. You are a man of God. Why not, girls, speak life into our children? Instead of saying boys will be boys, why don't we say boys will become men of God? Let's not put an expectation on our sons to do the boy thing. Let's say, because of the power of God within you, you can be the greatest prophet there ever was. What about saying to our girls, you're going to dress modestly. You're going to be women of great value and worth. You're going to be women who are set apart for the promises of God. I don't want to be a possessive mom. I don't want to hold my kids back. I want my kids to be in the center of the Lord's will. I mean, don't you want to be like Hannah, where you give and you ultimately trust? Who's got a 3-year-old in here? Can you imagine taking your 3-year-old, dropping him off at the tabernacle and going here? Some days. I love your honesty. Some days. Isn't that the truth? I mean, that's a mother whose heart is, I am going to trust you fully with my child. Sometimes you have a choice, sometimes you don't. I heard this story, and I'll close with this. I was talking with the pastor's wife, and I asked her, do you work outside the home? I don't know if I've told this story here or not. She said, I do. She said, I work in pediatric cancer hospice. So children with cancer who are in hospice, they're going to die unless God intervenes. And so I said to her, I said, you must have seen some just incredibly sad things. And she said, yes, I have. She said, there was one little boy I'll never forget. She said he was about 8 years old. And she said he had cancer, and we knew it was coming to his final days. So he was admitted to our care. Single mom, a believer, and a Jewish doctor who did not believe. She said, I was called to the house. I was there. I was on duty. And she said, you know, we knew it was very soon. And this little boy looked up at his mom with a childlike curiosity, not fear, but a childlike curiosity, and said, Mom, what's going to happen? At the end, what's going to happen? And she said, without missing a beat, this mom said, okay, this is what's going to happen. When you know it's time for you to go, you grab my hand and you just lift my hand up to heaven. She said, you hang on until you're ready. She said, when you're ready to go, you let go of my hand and then reach up, and Jesus is going to be waiting right there for you. You grab his hand. You go with him. I'm right behind you. She said, I'm coming soon. You just go with him. It's all going to be okay. And he said, okay. That was what he wanted to know. So this pastor's wife said a little while later, he began to breathe pretty hard, and we knew, okay, this is it. And she said, that little boy looked at his mom and grabbed her hand and raised it up to heaven. And she said, his hand just stayed there for a little while. She said, Marli, I'm not exaggerating. I'm not making this up. I'm telling you what I saw. She said that little boy's hand stayed there clinging to his mother. And in a few moments, he let go and he reached up. And she said he grabbed somebody else's hand. And she said, not only did I see that, but I saw the imprints of someone else's fingers in his flesh. And his little hand just stayed there. She said, and then just moments later, it just fell and he was gone. She said, and then we all lost it. She said, I turned around and I looked at that unbelieving doctor who was standing there going, is not that not an example of the ultimate trust of a mother? She had no choice to let go of her child, but she did have a choice in what she was going to believe in and who she was going to believe in and who, ladies, listen to me, she was going to entrust the care of her child with. Who better than the creator of life is going to care, provide, lead, break down the walls in your child's life than the one who created them? And I want to challenge and encourage you today to put your ultimate faith, trust, and hope in the name of Jesus, who created you and your precious kids. Father God, in the power of your name, I lift you up. I give you praise. I thank you for the miraculous work that you have done on the cross, in the grave, and now as you intercede for us, Jesus, praise your name. Father, if there's a woman here and they are really struggling today, Father, give them hope, deliverance, and healing, I pray. Help them to trust you, to believe you, and to depend on you. Thank you, Lord, for what you are doing and what you're going to do. In your name we pray, amen.
Lord, we want to lift your name on high. And Lord, we want to thank you for the works you've done in our lives. Lord, we trust in your unfailing love. Because you alone are God eternal. You've done in our lives, Lord, we trust in your